back here. My wall of fame, I call it, the graduation pictures. And so, you know, this is really, really important to me.
That's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you. So it's 7 o'clock. So I want to just go ahead and jump in and thank everybody for coming out. We have individuals representing the state of New Jersey. We have our Department of Education online. The whole department is here. I want to thank Dr. Rebelit for bringing the staff on to really enlighten our parents today on the education from zero from K to 12, but also we have early education here also. So there's a wide range of information that's going to be shared. So I want to take the opportunity to definitely make sure that we have an understanding that all questions that want to be addressed to this panel will be given the opportunity in your in the comments. So please put your questions in the comments. Our team will take the questions out of the comments. And I talked to the commissioner, and he did tell us that there's an opportunity that we may be able to get a lot of the questions answered. So I want to definitely take that opportunity. So feel free to put your questions that you have for the Department of Education inside of the chat so we can get them out to their respective departments. And that's another beauty. We have a lot of different departments. So just put the name of the department, if it's early education, if it's special need, whatever it is, so that way it can go to the right email and the right individual. So I thank you guys. And I'm going to turn it over to our our Commissioner of Education. And before we go into our next section of panel discussion, and we want to lead that off with our esteemed panelist, our Dr. Evans from Bloomfield College. So she's going to open the door to that experience. So this is a 2-hour experience, Department of Education, Bloomfield College. I want to thank the councilwoman from Camden, who is also here joining us to be a part of hosting our panel discussion. So once again, guys, and a big special thank you to Terrance Bankston, who worked with me thoroughly to make sure we were able to pull this off. And I'm gonna be honest, in less than a week, we were able to get the department up here. We were able to get the college here. We were able to get you parents here. We have over 42 people participating on the Zoom as we speak, and we're also Zooming live. So sit back, 45 minutes of engagement from our Department of Education, and then we're going to recap this information from the department with our partners at Bloomfield College, headed by our councilwoman, Shaneka Boucher and Terrance Bankston. So thank you, and Dr. Rebelit, take it away.
Thank you, Brother Altarese. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for inviting the Department of Education, Altarese, to take part in tonight's program. First, I applaud the members of Parents Engaging Parents for taking the time to become informed about important issues affecting your families. Parent engagement is a major goal of mine, too. In fact, shortly after I became Commissioner of Education, I created an Office of Civic and Social Engagement. We also began a social media campaign to reach even more people in New Jersey. You see, the department has traditionally done a good job of communicating with school officials. However, we have not always done such a great job at communicating with parents and other stakeholders outside of the educational ecosystem. That's why when we have an opportunity for civic engagement like tonight's program, it's all hands on deck. And you're going to see that tonight from my colleagues at the Department of Education. With me tonight, I have several assistant commissioners and directors. They can briefly discuss the major issues facing schools from preschool and special education to student testing and COVID-19. I can tell you this school year has been like any other in New Jersey's history. It started off on a high. For the first time, Education Week magazine annual ranking of states placed New Jersey number one in the nation. Our schools have always been highly rated, but always seem to come second behind Massachusetts. But this year, we could claim the crown of being number one in the nation. And thanks to our amazing educators, our phenomenal students, and more importantly, the parents and family members that support our kids. So we had a lot to be proud of. We were expanding preschool like never before. We were creating initiatives that focus on science and technology, and the governor's budget called for historic levels of funding in education. Then in January, it all began to change in a single word, and we understand that, coronavirus. I won't tell you what we've been going through the past few months, but I can tell you this, because as parents, you've lived through it with your families. Everyone has been struggling to adjust to a new normal, and that includes you, your children, and all the educators and administrators and support staff in your schools. But I want to share one anecdote that sums up my perspective as Commissioner of Education. See, just last night, I was asked by a reporter to summarize the lessons learned that we've learned, the lesson we've learned throughout this experience. And I did not want to talk about, I guess, the challenges, more so the negativity. I wanted to kind of highlight the positives. So, you know, begin by really looking at, we started this 25 days ago, going from brick and mortar to remote instruction. This is something New Jersey has ever been faced. No other commissioner, no other governor, no other teacher or educator, or student or parent had to face something like this. So schools had very little time to prepare. You're going from a brick and mortar to remote learning. Yet automatically, we saw everyone in the school community rally around the students. Everyone from educators, support staff, to principals, administrators, they all stepped up to the plate. But what I noticed, though, was the creativity, the innovation, the resilience of our educators. I've watched social media posts. I've actually even engaged with a student lesson down in South Jersey. And they were engaged, and they had a bunch of questions. And I'm sure as parents, you have a lot of questions as well. But more so, everyone had this spirit about them, whereas we're New Jersey. We've overcome obstacles. And even though we have the digital divide and we have challenges with haves and have-nots within our communities, but I do know that everyone is pulling in the same direction and pulling for your kids. So the thing that I talked about was the resiliency to the reporter. I learned that we're resilient, we're creative, and we are strong, and we're convicted in what we're doing. So let me be clear. Let me be very clear, parents and all stakeholders. Taking part in tonight's program like this is crucial to the school community. So thank you for your resiliency. Thank you for your creativity and your strength. And I wish you all the luck, the safe. I wish you please practice social distancing. Please ensure that your family is safe and you hunker down, because we can get through this, as the governor said. So thank you very much. Now I'm going to pull over for my team. And I think speaking follow me is Diana Pasculli. She is our Deputy Assistant Commissioner of Performance, Academic and Performance. So Diana. We can't hear you, Diana. Can we? So we're now going to move forward to technical difficulty on Diana's part. However, we're going to follow with Cary Booker, our assistant commissioner. He oversees the early division of early childhood. Cary?
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to join you this evening and talk a little bit about some of the work that we've been doing. Most of my time during this emergency has been focused on working with our sister agencies in the Department of Children and Families and the Department of Human Services to develop and stand up a program for emergency child care for the children of essential workers. And that process has been moving forward at a pace. And we now have a system of emergency child care in place that has started out. To date, we've received over 7,500 applications across the state. We have a little under 600 providers providing emergency child care for the children of essential workers around the state. And those children are children ages 0 to 13. And I see Dr. Beverly Lynn is on the call. Good to see you. And I know she is working hard in Essex County, CCRNR, to process those applications. And that is where folks should go if they want to apply to receive emergency child care. So I will pause here and turn it back over to the commissioner, and be ready to answer any questions that might come along.
So you see, Altarice, that we're doing a lot of work with our early childhood. Even though our students are in school, we're trying to engage and try to be very supportive of our sister agencies, because we understand that our first responders, frontline individuals, essential employees need that child care. And our job is to step up and to be able to support them as much as we can. So we would just want to just thank all those providers out there that have signed up to be a provider, and we look forward to working with you. So right now I'm going to actually pass it over to Dr. Julie Bunt. She is our director of the Office of Charter Schools. I just want to just pretty much, you know, just kind of take down any myths that we may have in regards to all schools in New Jersey, right? We look at all schools, whether it's traditional, whether it's Renaissance, whether it's charter schools, whether it's, we want to make sure we're on the same page. And so Dr. Julia Bunt will come in and just pretty much talk some of those things about the charter school world.
Thank you, Commissioner. And I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to be here this evening. I've worked with Al Therese both and with PEP and some of you, I'm sure, in my role as the director. I just want to begin by reiterating that we have great admiration for the hard work and diligent work of our educators, parents, and students while navigating these times. And while I respect your amazing work, it is in no way surprising. I have seen firsthand the incredible passion that educational impact produces. At the department, under the direction of the commissioner, we are committed to examining our charter authorization in conjunction with our partners to ensure that outcomes and impact of chartering is reflective of our shared commitment to high quality educational options. To that point, we have convened robust working groups to tackle what charter authorization might look like in the future. And at the same time, we are equally committed to limiting any additional stress or burden that might adversely impact our greatest assets. So at this point, I would like to just avail myself of the opportunity for any questions and to certainly let you know that I'm available via email and phone. And certainly, Altrice, if there's any questions that come up, we would be happy to answer them.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Julie. I appreciate that. So I'll often talk about the intersection between policy, practice, and performance. And so it's always important when you're looking at policy, and policy can be perceived as value statements, right? And as drivers of change. So I want Jesse Young, he's our jack of all trades. He's in the Office of Legislative Affairs, but he's more so like our senior policy advisor, the work that he's doing, along with Colleen Schultz, who heads up our COVID task force. But I wanted to ask Jesse to come along and just really talk about things in the federal scene, right, with the federal government, the USDOE, to make sure that we can maximize our resources by partnering with our federal agency. So Jesse, could you jump in, please?
Good afternoon. Thanks, Commissioner. And thanks, Mr. Frazier and the whole PEP team for this opportunity to speak tonight. So, yeah, we've been keeping close tabs on all of the policy updates and resources that come out of the U.S. Department of Education and have been thinking critically about how we can leverage all of those opportunities and resources that come out of USDOE to the benefit of New Jersey districts and students. So as a few examples, it's a federal law that requires states to administer statewide assessments, and the USDOE made an opportunity available to waive that federal law that requires us to administer assessments. We applied for that waiver, and that waiver was approved. So that was an opportunity we took to ensure that that districts and educators would be able to focus on meeting the needs of students and recovering from coronavirus without the additional burden of assessment. So that's kind of one example of a federal opportunity that we saw in New Jersey that we wanted to take advantage of. The U.S. Department of Education has also made money available under a law called the CARES Act, the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act. They've appropriated over $30 billion nationwide to support K-12 schools and institutions of higher education in their coronavirus recovery work. So we've been hard at work studying that law and preparing ourselves to, as soon as additional information comes available from the USDOE, to make sure that our students and our districts are able to take advantage of every dollar and every opportunity that comes our way through that federal law. So we've just been keeping real close tabs on the USDOE policies and just making sure that we take advantage of every opportunity that we have, every flexibility the federal government makes available, every dollar the federal government makes available, to make sure that we can take advantage of that to the benefit of our districts and students. So that's what we've been doing on the federal side.
Well, thank you, Jesse, for that update. I think it's important that you see exactly some of the work that we're doing. I'm not quite sure if Diana is still, Diana, is your audio working? Can you unmute yourself, please? Unmute?
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now. Jesse talked about policy. He talked about the CARES Act, which is the funding that we received. He also might have mentioned it, and Peggy will talk more about it in regards to the teletherapy that we have in the state to ensure that for our special needs population. But there's a couple of big things that came out, whether it's teacher evaluation, assessment's a big thing for parents. So I'm gonna have Diana kind of flush that information out for us in regards to the governor's executive order 117, which kind of gives the commissioner broad authority to suspend, to revise, and to edit any regulation that we actually have during this time in need. And I think it's important. And you'll see that at times we're going to make decisions. It's almost like flying a plane and gas at the same time, that as we start to foresee things, we might have to change regulation. This kind of gives me the authority to work with the governor's office and attorney general's office to make sure that we can actually have immediate action. So Diana's going to talk more right now regarding some of the things that apply to academics and performance. Diana?
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you for the opportunity. And that's exactly right. Once there was a federal pathway, we were able to act relatively quickly in ensuring that we were making sure that all of our focus was on our students' most important needs, and that they were being provided the resources they needed and the instruction. And so it didn't make sense to continue focusing on the assessment system. So once we were able to be relieved of that federal requirement, what we did was, that means that we were canceling the state assessments for ELA and math that used to be known as PARC, but now is NJSLA. And so that's for grades 3 to 8, and then the end of course assessments that students take in high school. So all of those assessments were canceled, as well as Access for L's, and there's a DLM assessment that takes place statewide. Those were all canceled in between March and April. And now, as the commissioner said, we are also, though, adjusting a lot of structures that were based on some of those assessments. So for instance, our class of 2020 has a graduation assessment requirement. And while we know that most of the class has already fulfilled that assessment requirement in order for graduation, we have about approximately 13,000 students as of the end of March, who had not yet completed the requirement. Typically, those students would engage in the portfolio appeals process with their district. And through the executive order and the commissioner's authority to waive some state rules, we were able just recently to eliminate that requirement, which means that all students this only applies to the class of 2020, those students no longer have to complete their graduation assessment requirement. So we think that was one of the greatest impacts on our students as far as assessments. And we're not planning for a makeup. Your third graders won't go back in October and have to take that assessment. It was eliminated for this year, spring 2020. And we're working with our fields and others. I see a quick question about SATs before I hand it over to my colleagues. We know that SAT assessments were postponed, and a lot of different assessments. We can get you more information. Those are run by the College Board across the United States. And we know that there are a lot of colleges making adjustments with the pause of SATs. And I think some of my colleagues in higher ed can talk about what that's doing to that process. But we know that there are a lot of pauses, but the AP assessment will be given remotely, we did find out. So even though we don't, those aren't New Jersey tests, we can certainly keep you updated about how students can get access to those.
Thank you, Diana. So as you can tell, the policy allows us to give, to unlock local innovation, to be honest with you. It's kind of like taking chains off of individuals and let districts get into the process of student learning. And I think during this time of this unprecedented time, we need to go back to thinking about student learning. And I think the policy deal unlocking and unleashing some innovation. So we have from assessments and graduation, evaluations, special education, federal and childcare. So we now have an opportunity to really look and say, how can we help these kids? And without necessarily looking at the constraints of an assessment. If you're an educator, we don't want you to think about the challenges of getting evaluated. We want you to think about what going every day and changing your teaching modality to deal with our students in a platform they've never been done before in regards to education. So I'm very happy when I talk about the intersection between policy and what we do in school systems, and to be able to have the flexibility in our schools is great. So right now I'm going to pass it over to our Assistant Commissioner of Field Services, AbdulSaleem Hasan, and he has a mantra, boots on the ground. And I think that has permeated throughout our 21 counties and our districts, because boots on the ground means the fact that we are everywhere in the county and the state, making sure that we put eyes on what's going on, because our goal is to make sure that if we don't see it, then we can't support you. So our boots on the ground mantra, led by AbdulSaleem Hasan and also Deputy Assistant Commissioner Kate Gallagher, today they're going to talk about that. So Mr. Hasan, can you just talk about the work that you're doing, whether it's through food security, looking at internet access for our students and devices? Hasan?
Thank you, Mr. Frazier, and also parent engaging parents. It's truly an honor to be on the call this evening to discuss this important work that we have been doing since we have all been indoctrinated in COVID-19. So just to talk about field services actually oversees all 630 plus school districts, and we are conduit information for all non-publics and charter and Renaissance schools. So we are the liaison to really put out that information to our county superintendents, who are definitely boots on the ground, and we have county offices that are working diligently with school districts and answering the call for any needs. One of the areas of emphasis when this first deception of COVID-19 is we had to deal with the whole thing of feeding students during the school a week. And we've been working diligently with that. I'm working with the state OEMs, the county OEMs, as well as the local OEMs, having a filtering system, making sure that all answers and concerns are being answered and taken care of. The local OEMs have been fantastic, making sure that they're providing support to the school district. Some of those areas that some schools have not been able to serve is at the school. So they've been partnering with the local community and serving out of churches. Some have been serving food daily, and some are serving food where they're doing shelf life food where they can serve every 2 or 3 days and weekly. So it's been an awesome challenge. Even with the backfilling of staff, OEM has been the answer in the call. So if there's any concerns or for parents out there, make sure you contact your superintendent there, and your superintendent will contact the county superintendent, and that information will uptrend up to us so we can solve all issues and concerns. We have also addressed what you may see concerns of essential staff. We've reiterated that topic and concerns to make sure that districts are able just to provide support. We're not expecting them to be there all day and do certain things, but whatever is a priority for districts to provide support to parents, they should be able to accommodate you. And if there are concerns about that, just make sure, again, you use that chain of command as far as getting it through your county superintendent and the uptrend. I'll just turn it over. Also, I'm just gonna close with this, but not to take up a lot of your time, but we also have a lot of podcasts online. Like the commissioner spoke earlier, we wanna be where you are all at. So we're on social media platforms, podcasts, we do Twitter chats, just to make sure that you all understand what this online learning platform is about. So I'm just going to turn it over to Kate just to talk about the technology piece, if you don't mind, Commissioner.
Ms. Hasan, I think we're going to, just real quick, let me just jump in. There was a question in there. I think someone put in as far as accountability. I think, is that a question, accountability, that came up?
Yes.
Well, I just want to just briefly talk about that. So the current accountability systems we have is a system that designed for traditional schools. And I think people need to understand that. The current accountability system we have, whether it's QSAC, whether it's evaluations of teachers, whether it's assessments, is currently designed for a system that's a traditional learning brick and mortar. We're now in transition to a remote learning environment. This is the first time, as I mentioned before, we're gassing the plane and flying at the same time. However, what we are doing though is ensuring that districts provide continuity of instruction. That's first and foremost. And the second thing is that they're providing food security for our students. Because during trying times, we have parents that are losing jobs. We have family members that are passing away. And the furthest thing I want to do is give an undue burden by making sure that Johnny is sitting there in that computer for 4 or 5 hours a day doing that work. There's different circumstances. Each district is unique. So therefore, the department, our job is to oversee this, but to give them flexibility by using the home instruction regulations to provide it to make sure that when they go to school every day, the school counts. Is it a perfect system? No, it's not. But it's a system that we have in place right now. Now, as we start to look at a reentry plan, a reopening plan, then we need to start looking at how do we hold districts accountable during a remote learning process. But that's while we're learning along the way, we identify gaps. But I'll be honest with you, since I don't support us right now going into a school and say, is this quality instruction? What I support is, are you doing your best to educate that kid and that student in that platform which you have? Because not every child has a device. And it's not fair to judge someone based off of someone else's zip code and the facilities they have, or home learning environment they have, or actually the tools that they use. But if districts are making an effort to provide continuous instruction for our students and feeding our kids, and we now come in to make sure that we document the work. That's what we talk about, boots on the ground. Mr. Hasan, document the work so we can go back. We meet with superintendents on a weekly basis. We meet with all the professional associations. We met with the charter school world. We meet with everybody to talk about some of the challenges. And as we start to put those challenges to make it major buckets, such as the digital divide, such as food security, such as assessment. How are we going to assess our child, our students, as we start to move out of this phase, right? What about the summer slide? Or what about the spring slide? We're starting to think about that right now. We're thinking about it thoughtfully and methodically to make sure that we get it right. So we are holding districts accountable, but that accountability system looks totally different from what we've come to accustomed to, because it's like taking a square peg, trying to put in a round circle, right? So we're not doing that right now because this has never been done before. So we are doing is documenting everything, analyzing it, and looking at gaps and working with everyone within the educational ecosystem. So when we get into this situation again, rest assured New Jersey schools will be prepared. So right now I turn it back over to Kate. Kate?
Thank you, Commissioner. And thank you everybody for inviting us into your homes on this Friday night. So as the commissioner said, in field services, our mantra is boots on the ground. Lately, that's been a little bit more virtual boots on the ground than physical boots on the ground. But the relationships that we have with districts through our county offices, through our comprehensive support network, really enable us to keep in touch with our school and district partners and to know what's going on with them, with students, you know, within their communities, so that there is a level of accountability, but something that we approach with a supportive mindset to ensure that we are not only supporting our students, but supporting our educators, knowing that everybody is stressed during this difficult time. So I think Assistant Commissioner Hasan asked me to speak a little bit about our work around technology. We have surveyed districts a few times about what devices they have available for students to use for remote and virtual learning, about how many students they have and families that are not able to connect to the internet at home for purposes of remote learning, and a variety of other things. So we just received updated data that indicates that fewer students, or rather more students are able to connect to the internet at home than 2 weeks ago. And so that's very good news, right? There is less of a need reported by districts for Chromebooks and iPads than there was 2 weeks ago. So all of that suggests to us that districts are working fast and furious to get devices out to students, to help students get connected at home, to help families be connected, and to really ensure that high quality learning is happening. But we know that every school community is different. In some places, the devices may not be the answer. Each student is different. And so for some students, the device may not be the answer. So under those circumstances, what do? We try to support our districts in being innovative to meet each student's individual needs. So now that we have some solid data to work with to understand what the needs are in our schools and districts, and we will continue to stay in touch to stay abreast of the latest, because we know our districts are continuing to chip away at that digital divide, But now that we have that data to work with, what are we gonna do about it? I think partly it goes back to something that Jesse mentioned about taking advantage of all available federal opportunities, funds flowing through the CARES Act, other federal funds that flow to districts that may be underutilized, working with partners in foundations, in private corporations, anywhere that we can look to try to chip away at this problem and to increase connectivity for students. So that's our charge. That's what we've been working on for the last 25 days. And that's what we'll continue to be working on, as well as many other things, the food, security, and lots of other really important pieces. So thank you again for the opportunity to join you tonight.
Well, Kate, thank you very much. Yeah. I would like to introduce, we have our state board member, Fatima Watkins online. She's actually somewhere in the universe there. But I wanted to acknowledge the work that she's doing as a state board member. I'm not quite sure if she has the ability to chime in, but if you can, I would love Therese, if she can join the conversation. So Fatima, if you're out there, please see if you can actually get on the conversation. I would love for you to bring greetings on behalf of the state board and thank you for coming. I'm sure that Mr. Frazier would love to have your commentary as you sit upon the state board looking down in regards to the work we're doing from a policy stance. So for Fatima, thank you for joining us. So Therese, if you can get her on, that'd be great. Right now, I just want to introduce Dr. Kelly Williams. She works in, she's one of our directors in field services. But it's important because when people talk about this new normal, right, this remote learning, some of the things that we need to address our students' social and emotional, the mental health, whether it's our educators, whether our students, right, because you know these are different times. So therefore, they're accustomed to one structure, and we're now telling them you need to work in this. And if they don't necessarily have the tools to work in that environment, they may get frustrated based on that. So the department has been thinking and working with our district leaders and providing resources to ensure that we address some of that social and emotional need, making sure the mental health issues are being addressed from our level. So I will let Dr. Kelly Williams turn it over to you so you can just talk more about that, Kelly. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, and thank you all for the invite this evening. It's truly an honor. So just as the Commissioner stated, as well as Kate, right, these unprecedented times, they bring about stress, not only in students, but of course, parents and educators as well. Quarantining at home may be an experience that is okay for some, right? And some of us that are sort of introverts and introverted extroverts, we enjoy it. But for many families and students across the state, it's not an enjoyable experience. And so our goal is really to work to mitigate those stress levels, again, in students, in educators, and in families. Many families are forced to be teachers, right? And so it is a difficult time, and we do acknowledge that. So towards that end, what we've done the first week is to provide executive county superintendents with resources the very first week of school closures that can be shared with school leaders and chief school administrators. These resources focused on establishing systems and a distributive approach to wellness checks for students, ensuring that teachers are not the only ones with the touches on students. We need to make sure that everyone has a touch on students and that all students really have an opportunity to connect with an adult. We know how important that is. Also, our office has developed our introductory SEL social and emotional learning modules, and they've been posted on the website for a few months now. And so those modules can be used at home. They can be used again by school leaders. They can be used by teachers. And so the goal of those modules are really to introduce folks to social and emotional learning. Many times we sort of, I think it's one of those things you think you know what it is, but you may not. And so it really is an overview for anyone to be able to dive in this work. It's great for teachers. We always encourage educators to sort of take a pause during the week. Again, we know it can be stressful with interactive and virtual and remote learning lessons, but it's important to really take a pause and be able to incorporate many programs and practices such as, you know, meditation and reflection and just time for kids to be kids, right? And sort of just take a break from everything. On March 27th, it was International SEL Day around the world. And we are very pleased to announce that New Jersey had the highest level of participation from all of the states in the United States. And you know, New Jersey, which is often called the armpit of America and very small. Again, hey, 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 states, I know that analogy is really odd, but I think that is appropriate because we're so small and we beat out states like Texas and other really large, in California, we had more, we had more participation than any other state. But my point to that, it just goes to show how dedicated our leaders in our schools and our districts are to this work. Every single Friday, we broadcast live in partnership with School Boards Association to sort of have a Friday pause featuring Alicia DeLorenzo, a master trainer and artist in this work. And so it really is an opportunity for parents, students, and again, educators to really take a pause and see this work in action. It's one thing if you read it in a brochure, in a resource guide on the internet, but it's another thing if you can literally have someone in front of you to walk you through the exercises. And that's also what we've been doing. I think that may cover it. Oh, also one more thing on the DOE website, we have a student wellness tab that specifically focuses on you know, mental health and resources and places so that if teachers and educators, right, if they notice a child that is perhaps spiraling or something just isn't right, they know exactly where to turn their resources for that, phone numbers. And my team developed that in conjunction with Kim Buxenbaum's team in another division, the Office of Special Ed. So they've been extremely instrumental in that work. So we're also in the process of adding grief resources because unfortunately that is our new reality for many, again, students and educators. They've experienced their own personal grief perhaps, or even in their schools, and just grief from not being around students and teachers and potentially not having an in-person graduation, right? Which is, I mean, it's a reality. And so we've created resources to be able to facilitate those conversations between their virtual educators and parents and students. So if you have any questions, please fire away.
So Kelly, can we, why don't you just mention, we're talking about our after action reports and white papers. So Kelly, sure. And Kate Gallagher, they'll be working to put together a documentation, a research paper to kind of really kind of look at what we're doing, compare us to other states, do a lit review in regards to looking at other states and the work that they're doing to make sure that we truly can understand this pandemic situation. So if we ever come back to this situation again, we'll be guided by research and science and fact, as our governor says. So she's going to talk about that briefly.
Kate, do you want to take it away? Or do you want, okay.
Kelly, go ahead.
So, okay, great. So we have a team, an internal team of, so it's a few things going on. So we have, as commissioner, it is a white paper where, again, we are really getting ahead of the eight ball and really capturing what exactly our plan has been to sort of get to where we are so that in the event, God forbid, if something else is to occur, whether it's Corona or any other pandemic or anything of that nature, we have on record what we've done as a department from day one all the way till the end, right? And yeah. So the goal of that is really to be proactive and again, dealing with anything else that should occur. But more importantly, we know that our practices are sound. We are led by a solid leader. And we wanna make sure again, that we capture and memorialize everything that we do so that we can perhaps go out and present to folks to show them how New Jersey really does it in the areas of everything you've heard tonight and then more. So we're actually looking forward to that and we're actually looking forward to partnering with a research and evidence-based organization to really help us lead that will help us lead this work in the best way possible.
So, Kate, is any way you could talk about some of the components of the white paper that we talked about the other day?
Yes, absolutely, Commissioner. So part of it is reflecting on what actions we've taken. And part of it is looking at what has gone on in districts as this shift to remote instruction has unfolded. What's worked, what challenges have been faced, capturing some of the best practices that we see happening, and really putting forth a piece of research that helps guide districts all around the country to be able to move from traditional sort of in-person instruction to virtual instruction at the drop of a hat. We don't know what the future is going to hold as we navigate our way through this pandemic. We see some wonderful things happening. That's my 15-month-old. I apologize, everybody. We see wonderful things happening in New Jersey across all of our districts, and we really just want to have an academic discipline study of what's gone on so that we can share that wealth of knowledge with others and they can learn from what we've done.
Well, thank you, Kate. So you're going to see the flow in which we have this today. So we're talking about the policy piece, the practice, the academics. You get down to the social and emotional piece. So, but it kind of goes, I mentioned earlier that policy sometimes can be value statements. So when the governor talks about a stronger and fairer New Jersey, and he really reiterates a stronger and fairer educational system, that encompasses the whole child. So we're just not looking at the reading, writing, arithmetic. We're also looking at how our kids are coping and do they have the skills to sit in front of any platform, any method to learn. I think it's important that we start to really think about that, all right, and looking at the whole child. So we're going to talk about, we have our social and emotional piece. What about some of our students who have different learning abilities, right? Our students have different learning abilities and some of the challenges that they're having right now currently and some of the things that we're doing to address that and working with our districts to be able to provide these services telepathically, telepathically instruction, teletherapy, or we can actually do it through compensatory later on. So right now I'm going to have Assistant Commissioner Dr. Peggy McDonald. She oversees the Offices of Student Services. And she's here with our director, Kim Buxenbaum. So Peggy, can you start us off and then pass it to Kim and talk about some of the work that you're doing? And also you really talk about some of the challenges that you see in some of the work that you and Kim and everyone else is doing to make sure that we can address some of our students' needs.
Sure. Thank you, Commissioner, and thank you, everyone. And thank you for having me on tonight. It's really an honor to be here. And I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you about this. So I'm going to start with some of the challenges that our kids are facing and the services that we're providing to help our educators and our families meet the needs of those students. One of our vulnerable populations is kids who are experiencing homelessness. And so through our federal law, the Every Student Succeeds Act, which is really about that, making sure every kid succeeds. We have federal funding that supports regional programs. And in those regional programs, there are people who work with every single school district across the state with a homeless coordinator so that there is a person in every district who is there to ensure that kids who are experiencing homelessness not only have get the educational services in times like this, but are also accessing food and have a roof over their heads. So our homeless coordinator, Phoebe Thomas, is really working, meets with our regional coordinators every week, and their services that are being provided, and relationships forged with some community agencies as well to fill those gaps. Another area is English learners. So we have staff who are preparing and putting resources online for our ESL and bilingual teachers so that our English learners don't fall behind more, you know, in this time as well. And we still have kids who are coming in as newcomers to the state. So we want to be sure that those kids are enrolled in school and that they are engaged in services. So we have a team working on that as well. Another key part of our Every Student Succeeds Act is family engagement. So we have staff who are putting resources out again to engage families. One of the unique opportunities we've seen, and one of the aspects of our division is actually a school for the deaf. And so we get to see firsthand teachers working, and some of the teachers have told me that they see more of parents now than they do during the typical school year. So it's a unique opportunity for educators and administrators to engage with families directly and to help them support their kids. So family engagement is a key aspect both during the year and during this time. And as I said, we have our Cats in Back School. So we have kids from all over the state who are again receiving virtual instruction. I'm going to turn it over to Kim to talk a little bit more about special education. I just wanted to address one of the issues that popped up in the chat box. With regard to special education, again, we have federal laws that ensure that every kid with a disability is entitled to a free and appropriate public education and an education that meets their needs. And during this time, it's very difficult to provide all of the services that our kids would typically get. So our federal government has said that we want to ensure that kids are getting the services that they should according to the plans that have been developed for them individually to the maximum extent appropriate. And at the federal level, there is some talk of waivers, but nothing has come down to that direction. So our mantra is that these kids should be getting the services to the maximum extent appropriate. So I'm going to turn it over to Kim, who's the head of one of our offices of special ed, to talk more about that.
Peggy, before Kim come on, I just want to make sure now we have all the technical glitches out the way for our state board member, Fatima Burm.
We got a little budget over here, man. Calm down.
I want to fit this come in and speak, but before I have her come on, I often talk about during leadership during unprecedented times. Call for acts of leadership and humanity. So when you have a partner in the state board, that, like Fatima, that's working side by side, shoulder by shoulder to ensure that we allow districts to have the flexibility they can to truly educate our students, it's very important that we just lead, but with the thought of humanity running through that. So Fatima is one of those examples of leading with humanity and in her position as a state board member, and she's very valued. So Fatima, I'm glad you are part of this conversation. Thank you.
Thanks, Commissioner.
You go.
Thanks, Commissioner, and thanks for the invite. Hey, Altarese, so many familiar faces. I'll be brief. One, just to say, like, I've been super duper impressed just with the DOE and all who are behind the scenes to just make this shift happen. I mean, we are in unprecedented times, and we keep saying it, the Commissioner says all the time, like, New Jersey is leading the way. We have so many amazing educators, and the way they are showing up and showing out, frankly, is just remarkable. There's so many examples. I mean, I have examples like you see the parades of them just going to talk to kids. I just witnessed an educator sit on the front, she sat on the front steps of a kid's house and read them a book. It was appropriate. It was more than 6 feet of social distancing, but because that kid was having a hard time. And she was bilingual. And so she came and just read a book to them. So there's so many examples. My kids' teachers call them every single day to just check in to see how they're doing. So our educators are stepping up as we know they would, but just in these unprecedented times to shift on a dime has been amazing to see. And then as a parent who's running a seventh grade classroom right now, I have seventh grade triplets, it's tough. It is tough. And I taught for 6 years of high school, but it's tough. And they're grieving the loss of school year and loss of friends, and they're trying to adjust as well. And so what we say at our home every single day is, we are not stuck at home, we are safe at home, and we're trying to not waste a crisis. And so I just, as a parent, I'm getting a chance to see where my kids, what my kids are doing, what they're learning even more in depth, how they learn, the time of day they learn best. And so my hope is that we learn a whole bunch, not just about like what the systems and policies and structures that this is sort of forcing us to look at more in depth, but that we also start to look at the individual and whole child and really understand the different ways that we can be educating our kids and what they need to do that. So I am excited to be here. Thank you, Altarese, for pulling this together. Thank you to everyone out there for all that you're doing to make sure that we still lead with vision, with excellence, and frankly, with humanity, as you said, Commissioner, and that we think about our most vulnerable kids, even right now, ever more right now, we think about our most vulnerable kids and really figure out all the things that we can do to make sure that in the midst of all this, that they are not forgotten and that we're doing everything we can to make sure that they get the education they deserve, even in the midst of a pandemic. So I'm excited to partner with the DOE and especially the Commissioner, and I thank y'all for all the work you're doing.
Well, thank you very much, Fatima. I think Fatima really hit the nail on the head. And when we talk about accountability, you can't quantify dedication. You can't quantify the passion of those teachers that do drive-bys, that make phone calls, do wellness checks. You can't quantify that because there is no tool that's out there to address or evaluate the work that we're doing right now. What I'm seeing across the board is really, we talk about humanity. I'm seeing the entire educational ecosystem coming together to make sure that the kids get the best that they can during these circumstances. And thank you very much, Fatima, for highlighting that, because that's important for people to know that the educators out there working hard. But kudos to your parents. You just indicated that you're working and the fact that you're a teacher at home. So it's important for us to recognize the work that you're doing, because as Dr. Tracy Severance would say, she's the former chief academic officer, she would sit and say, collaboration is co-labor. So when you're having this collaboration, this co-labor between schools and between the educators and between the students and the parents and the families, it's a beautiful thing to see. And that's the stuff that's enlightening to me when I talk about, you know, the work that we're doing, because we're going to have plenty of time to dissect this and go through the challenges and find these gaps. But right now, when everyone is hunkered down and doing what we need to do, we need to uplift those individuals and to give them praise for what they're doing and the effort they're giving. And then we can hold people accountable as we move forward, because this is our new normal for now. So right now, I'm going to kick it back over to Kim. I apologize, Kim, but I wanted to give my state board member, Fatima, an opportunity to really to weigh in and to address that on behalf of the board. Thank you, Fatima. Kim?
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Commissioner. I appreciate the time being able to come here, and to my Assistant Commissioner, Peggy McDonald. So the Office of Special Education has tried to jump on, as with everybody else in the across the different divisions of the department, to try to jump on what do we need to do to be able to support our students, especially for our students with the special needs. Some of our students have really significant challenges on a good day in a regular brick and mortar building. And so to try to start to figure out what we can do to support our educators as we're shifting from that brick and mortar education to this virtual online education, definitely has been taking a lot of work and a lot of cross collaboration with the different divisions and offices in the department. As my colleague, Dr. Kelly Williams, gave me a shout out, thank you very much. We were working really hard to try to put some supports together, and we've been having some really good conversations across the different departments, because as we all know, kind of special education touches almost every area of education, and academics, social, emotional, all of those pieces, assessment. So one of the first things that we really worked to do was to start talking right away with our county offices, who are our direct connection to our directors and our educators and our parents in the field. We made sure that one of the first things that we knew we were having some challenges with in terms of the virtual instruction was not necessarily the instruction, but what do we do around the related services provision? This was something in New Jersey that was something that was a little bit more of a challenge for us. And right away, we were able to act quickly with our State Board of Education, who are a group of fabulous people, to get some emergency regulations passed to make sure that we could have virtual and other online platforms for our related services. We did that emergency package on April 1st, and then our fabulous Governor Murphy, just the other day on Tuesday, also passed a law around the virtual instruction that helps all of our kids, but also has specific language in there for students with disabilities to make sure that they also get their access to the education, to different related services like speech and the counseling, physical therapy, all of those things. So all of that really has helped our districts. We've been hearing from the field that it's really helped our districts be able to provide more supports and be able to try to meet the challenges of providing those individual education plan supports and services in the virtual reality that we are in now. The other things that we've really been working hard to do is to start putting out different resources for our parents. It's hard being home. It's hard when you're an educator to be home with your kids all day and educate students. So those parents that have other jobs and have to go out and do their work and try to come home and also work with their parents. Some folks have students from preschool up into middle school or high school. So they've got five schooling, you know, grades going on at a time. That can be really challenging. So on our website, we have a special education tab. We have information on there for instructional resources just to help with different strategies around your reading, your writing, your math at the different grade levels. We have resources up there that look at our preschool age children that have disabilities all the way up through our high school and older students. So we want to make sure that we have those organized. We understand that we have some students that are nonverbal or have more behavioral challenges. So we have some resources up there about how to talk to your students about what's happening with COVID through social stories, not just through your typical academic instruction. And so how do we use social stories? That's something that some of our special education parents will be familiar with, because that's something that they work with in schools. And then we've had regular meetings with our county offices. Our leadership had a meeting with the State Parent Advocacy Network the other day, so we could hear from them about what they're hearing from parents. We check our emails and our voicemails every day, so we're getting and responding to phone calls and emails from parents, phone calls and emails from our different educators, different related service providers, all types of folks from the field. But it also is really important for us to talk to that parent advocacy network as well, because they have a really strong link to our parents. And so the phone call with them went really well in terms of trying to figure out what are other things we need to do to be able to support, and what are some things that we need to know to be able to assist that process. We're also going to be hosting meetings region-wide across the state, so we can speak with our approved private schools and our directors of special education and our local education agencies, right? Our boots on the ground people that Kate Gallagher was talking about before. So we have all those, we're having lots of conversations. We're trying to make sure that we keep connected to all of our teachers and our parents, and to respond as soon as we can with as much guidance as we can to try to help ourselves or help everybody through this. It's definitely a challenge. But I've found, at least for myself, working at the Department of Education under Commissioner Repollet, he has a great team. He has good people with him, and he makes sure that we're all talking to each other and doing and making the best decisions for kids every day. So thank you for that, and thank you for allowing me to be here. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Kim. So you see, Brother Frazier, Therese, you see that when I talk about the intersection between policy, practice, and performance, I really mean that. So we're talking about the policies. So in that case, we must just shout out our legislators, led by our Senate President Steve Sweeney, led by the Assembly Speaker Craig Coughlin. But more particularly, I want to shout out the legislators that have been working hard with these last few months, last couple of days, phone calls challenging us to make sure that we are really looking into the digital divide, making sure the devices, whether it's Senator Rice calling on behalf of the Black Caucus and asking questions, whether it's Senator Ruiz calling us, making sure there's equity and we address inequities within our educational system, or with Assemblyman Caputo talking and advocating for our teachers, for teacher evaluation, whether it's Assemblywoman Jacy, that's really challenging us to make sure that we don't forget about our students of special needs and such challenges. And we also have Assemblywoman Timberlake, McKnight. So we've had conversation, you can see, and more in particular, Assemblywoman Wimberly. So you'll see that the conversation we have kind of drive the work that we do. So I want to thank them for putting forth together bills and packages that the governor signed. I want to shout out Governor Murphy. When he talks about a stronger and fair New Jersey, he truly means that. He walks the walk. He doesn't just talk it. Led by our Lieutenant Governor, she's the same way, supporting us, making sure that we provide that. And then you have the support system that the First Lady give, you know, by working with us, making sure what are some of the needs that you have as a state that she and her group of friends can support that way. So it's a whole, as the governor would say, a whole of government approach. Shout out to our Commissioner of Health, Julie Percicelli, for the work that she's doing to make sure that we are informed every day with the governor at our press conferences, whether it's our Colonel Callahan, State Police, enforcing our stay-at-home laws and regulations. So you see, it's a whole of government approach, whether it's DCF, Christina Norbert Byers, making sure that we don't forget about our students. We don't forget about child abuse. We don't forget about our educators that may be involved in domestic violence. Or is it DHS making sure that, you know, led by Kyle Johnson, Commissioner Kyle Johnson, making sure that we have safe learning environments for the children of our first responders. So you'll see this is not in isolation. all of our cabinet members, the whole cabinet approach is really addressing these issues. These are unprecedented times. And I can sit and say, we do best when we collaborate, co-labor versus isolation. I wanna thank you, Brother Al Therese, for giving us this platform to come in to speak to the people. As we talked about before, we wanna make sure this message resonates, not just within our normal education ecosystem, but go beyond that and make sure that we're providing information to parents, making sure it's transparent and making sure that they have the right information. So thank you very much on behalf of the Department of Education, on behalf of Governor Murphy. I really want to appreciate PEP for really inviting us today. So thank you.
Definitely. Thank you. Thank you all. And I want to definitely give a big thank you to the power that you brought to the table today, Commissioner. You brought the whole bandwidth of the Department of Education to give to the parents an opportunity to get it straight from the leaders. So I appreciate it. I thank you. I definitely want to thank everybody that has stayed on the line, my panel that's coming on behind us, who's going to give the parents an opportunity to recap all the, this hour worth of information engagement, because that's important that we now, after we get this information, really hash down on how we can turn this into action to support the work that you're doing, the work that the State House is doing, the work that our governor is doing in the state, and then the work that parents are doing at the front line as the champions they are. So once again, I want to thank you all for joining this podcast. I want to thank you all for spending this Friday evening. We changed the game. Commissioner said Friday at 7. I said, hey, man, that's where the parents at. And we had over 60 participants today. We streamed it live. So I want to thank you for this opportunity. And we look forward to whenever you would like to give the message to the parents or the audience an opportunity to come back to this platform and share current real information so our parents can really be steadfast on how we move forward in this crisis and help on our anxiety and stress, because it's real out here in the field, as they say. So I'm going to turn it over to our guests. I want to thank you all for coming on again, Department of Education. We look forward to talking to you guys again to spread the word to the parents. And now we have our host.
Department Sealand. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Al Therese.
Thanks, everyone.
We want to turn it over now, everybody, to our next session, which is our recap session of this beautiful opportunity of information and sharing. And I want to bring in a special guest that I had the opportunity to talk to just a little bit, but don't even mess up her distinguished resume and accomplishments, but definitely want to get an opportunity to turn it over to a leader who's coming to New Jersey, just bulldozering into cultivating leaders and stepping into different platforms of engagement for our people. So with that, I want to definitely thank and bring in Dr. Evans, from the president of Bloomfield College, and welcome her as she introduces our panel host, and we go into our panel discussion and recap. So thank you, ma'am.
Awesome. No, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. You know, what I want to do first off is, a lot of times when people are doing Zoom conferences and Zoom meetings, there's an intensity and there's an anxiety or stress or rapidity that goes really, really fast, that you feel as if you have to get all this information out in a short period of time. And yes, you do. But what it does, though, it actually makes you a little bit more anxious. People don't realize that my background is actually in counselor education and supervision. And I've been doing distance education and learning and video conferencing for a while. So what I want to urge people to do is just breathe, slow down a little bit. You know, the emotions and the affect that you have when you're talking to a person face-to-face is still there, right? So, and maybe it's a Southern thing, because I'm coming from Texas and I'm an Alabama girl. I get used to this Northeast, like, slow down, y'all. You know, breathe. It's okay. It's okay. I'm still listening. You know, as I mentioned earlier, I'm very excited about participating with you tonight. Parents engaging parents. I'm a mother of six, and five of them are daughters. And I always say God has a sense of humor, because I was an athlete and he gave me six daughters, and I didn't play with baby dolls when I was a little girl. So he gave me real live baby dolls that I had to deal with. And so, you know, this education thing is real. I was raised by my grandparents in Alabama during the civil rights movement. And, you know, I was told over and over again that education is the key. And I've shared with some people, and I'm sure with Mr. Bankston as well, that I had a young man come up to me in the fall and says, yeah, Dr. Evans, I know education is the key, but they keep changing the lock on us, you know. And I'm like, oh, wow. I had to kind of pause for a second. And it really made me teary, you know. You know, as parents, as educators, we keep telling them, baby, get your education. If you get your education, then you can do whatever you want. Nobody can ever take your education away from you. So I made it my purpose in life, being raised by my grandparents and actually legally adopted by them. We dealt with food insecurity. We dealt with a lot of different things that Commissioner Repollet talked about earlier. I understand that. And as being a counselor too, I work with students over and over again, students with special needs. I was a rehab counselor, teacher from elementary all the way up through people getting their doctorates. I understand the importance of that. So that's the reason why I'm at Bloomfield College. I came all the way from San Antonio, Texas, where I've been for 21 years. Fell in love with the students at Bloomfield College, which is predominantly Black and also Hispanic serving institution. So a lot of Black and Brown students, about 90%. About 75% of our students are first generation trying to get an education. The median family income for our students is $32,000. Just think about that for a second. $32,000, but yet these students are working 2 to 3 jobs just trying to change their lives, transforms not only their lives, but their families. It's a system thing. So we're excited about Mr. Bankston being a part of our team. He's coming in, he's an alum, he's a student leader on campus. And this is kind of, an example of what happens at Bloomfield. You learn the importance of giving back. That you've got to give back. And when something's been given to you, what do you do with it? And for me, that's the greatest joy of giving back. So I'm gonna turn it over to Mr. Bankston, who's now our interim leader for our student leadership and engagement. And he's been doing a phenomenal job of really this whole virtual experiences. We're still trying to make sure that our students are engaged because, you know, I think it was Dr. Williams that was talking earlier about loss. You have physical loss where people die. But you have all other types of losses as well. You have actually the loss of freedom, which a lot of us are experiencing right now. And I'm an extrovert. This is actually being in this house, and I'm in kind of in a nice size house. It's driving me crazy. And my husband, though, he's an introvert, and he's having a good time. He's listening to podcasts and all this other stuff. If I listen to one more podcast, I think I'm going to scream. But anyway, I'm excited about being here and engaging you all tonight, and I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Bankston. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Evans. Altarese, thank you as well for engaging and allowing Bloomfield College to be a part of this statewide initiative. Many of the parents that I've met through PEP also represents the values, the core values of Bloomfield College. And so it was important, imperative that if it was to be a first, that we would be a part of helping to lead the charge. And we are too celebrating the first. I know that our commissioner is the first African-American commissioner for the state of New Jersey, and we have the first Black president of Bloomfield College and also the first female. So Dr. Evans, thank you for your leadership as well. And I just want to turn it over really quickly to our esteemed councilwoman from Camden, who I have the pleasure of co-moderating this panel.
Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure really to be on here tonight. I know we talked a little bit about loss. So excuse my energy today in Camden City. We lost one of our greats, Miss Martha Wilson. So my heart is a little bit heavy, but being on this call tonight is extremely important because we know at this moment, we have to make sure that our parents and all of our families are very aware of what's happening. And I just wanna thank Altarese and his team, including Erica, for putting this together because that's a true testament of leadership. And under the leadership of PEP, we are able to all come together to make sure that our families are dealing with this because it is really, really heavy. As we talked about the social emotional impacts, I think that every single day that we're all learning from. And right now in Camden, you know, we are facing the same thing, but it's really a pleasure to see how well the Department of Education handled things. I've seen it firsthand for our families here in Camden where we have food deserts and we face a lot of food insecurity. What I have seen over the last few weeks have been nothing short but amazing in regards to how schools were making sure that our families were fed, You know, sometimes during the week, I also volunteer to make sure that we're passing out meals. But those things that we're doing to come together virtually and when we get opportunities to be together in person have just been super important for the families that we are all here to serve and service. So I'm just, again, extremely appreciative of being on this call with you all tonight so that we can, you know, talk a little bit more about what we can do for the communities on a local level, you know, on a state level. And again, for AbdulSaleem for having the forethought of just connecting people in communities across the state, because the work that we all do, as we can see tonight, is so interconnected and important. So again, shout out to PEP. And Terrance and I are looking forward to continuing to moderate this conversation. And congratulations again to Dr. Evans for being the president of the college. We are so happy to have you here, and I've heard such wonderful things. So thank you for being on this platform tonight. So we can get into a recap.
Just a sec.
Sorry, that's my phone. So we can get into a little bit of a recap. I know that there are a few questions that came up. Terrance, do you want to take a quick look at some of those together?
Yeah, one of them that stood out because I think
real quick, guys, before you do that, can we introduce the rest of the panel?
Please.
Sure.
Well, let's start with the first lady, Erica. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Good evening, everybody. My name is Erica Beverett. I am a part of Parents Engaging Parents. I'm the Southern Regional Director. I've been a teacher for 7 years at Children Home Society of New Jersey Head Start, and I'm a proud parent of 2 high schoolers. I'm just super excited to be here and to be able to connect with our communities all across New Jersey. It's just been a lot of hard work and heart work. That's what I live by. And I definitely follow my heart when it comes to keeping the connection with people, with parents, with children. That's my passion. So I just thank you for tuning in tonight, and I'm going to pass it over to Dr. Renee.
Good evening, everyone. I'm happy to be here. I'm a primary care pediatrician at Boston Medical Center and direct a community engagement network called Vital Village, which allowed me to engage with the Essex County Council for Young Children and the PEP, Parents Engaging Parents program. So I'm so happy to be here this evening. I am also the proud parent of an elementary schooler, middle schooler, and high schooler here in Essex County, and I am learning a lot from them during this whole parent home instruction process. So happy to be here tonight.
Curtis.
Good morning. Good evening. Excuse me. Sorry, long day. I'm Curtis Palmore. I'm the CEO of Community Charter School of Paterson. We're a small district, charter school district in Paterson, New Jersey. And I've been engaged with PEP for 3 years now. A number of our parents and some of our workers have been engaged in advocacy work. I'm also a parent of 2 children, elementary school children, and a doctoral student as well. So aspiring to do what many of the folks on this esteemed panel have right now. And I'm excited about maybe sharing some hands-on experience and how we have transitioned our work to better serve parents in this distant learning environment. And Altrius is like a brother to me, so anytime he calls me, I would definitely support this work. And Dr. Evans, I also have Alabama roots as well. My folks are from Camden, so maybe we could talk one day, because we probably see each other at the family reunion or something.
All I can say is roll tide, but anyway.
That's right.
Someone who probably doesn't need an introduction, but is definitely a powerhouse when you talk about parents, and that is Dr. Beverly Lynn, who I'm honored to be able to be on the panel with.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. I have to talk a little bit about AlTerese because AlTerese was our parent co-chair for the Essex County Council for Young Children. And, you know, we were all about building parents up and making sure that they succeed. And he has gone into PEP and it's just all over the state. It's a wonderful thing. And we're just very proud to be a part of the work that he's doing with PEP. I want to suggest to you, though, today that parent engagement has taken on a new meaning. It is not the parent engagement that we had before the coronavirus. Parent engagement, when we talked about it previously, was more so about getting involved with your children and their educational process, but also being decision makers, being part of that decision-making process so you get to influence what happens with your children. So today, as it relates to parent engagement, it's about teaching your children. It's about creating new routines. It's about trying to assist your children emotionally and socially to make sure that they are okay in the midst of helping yourself become okay and keeping your family in some type of routine. So I'm going to stop there because Assistant Commissioner Booker talked a little bit about the work that we're doing with essential workers and childcare needs. And so I'll talk about that when it's my turn.
So there was some questions, Councilwoman, that I'm not sure if got answered. And I know there is a lot of concern, not just in North, but around the state about the, I guess the lack of services and the need for more services when it comes for our children with disabilities. And so there's a concern of parents and I think advocates for special needs in terms of what are we doing? Are we zooming these type of IEP evaluations or assessments? What is gonna be the role on that? Does anyone on the panel have any feedback, or is that something that you're dealing with inside your respective organization? Councilwoman, I'm sure that there are constituents you have in Camden that are perhaps thinking the same thoughts.
I mean, I saw that Curtis is ready to respond. And just from the point of view that we have here, I do hear a lot from parents who have that same concerns. And I'm recapping what I heard the panel say. A little bit earlier, they said that they didn't really get a lot of direction from the federal government. So right now, as of today, the services that were intact are supposed to remain intact. And I guess we have to figure out how to help our families through this. And as they talked about the digital divide, sometimes I really worry about our families who have students with special needs and how are they coping right now with, you know, sometimes those students have difficulties in small environments, but we absolutely know they have a lot of trouble adjusting to change. As we all are having difficulty adjusting to change. So right now, and it is a major concern, and I do hear from families all the time, talking about the concerns that they have or not having the proper services for their children. So that's a lot of concern. And again, here locally, we always try to touch base with our superintendent and try to make sure that they stay on top of it and touch base with principals to make sure that they are on top of what they need to be on top of. But they are still, again, always going back to these are unprecedented times and people are really trying to adapt as quickly as they can during these times. And Curtis, as a school leader, we would love to hear from you on, you know, what you are doing right now with your students.
Yeah, so I take this response personally first. My son has an IEP for speech and language. And to be very honest with you, this is my 25th year in education. And I can tell you right now, even with my expertise, I'm not equipped to give my son the speech services that he needs. And while when the pandemic first started, I really give a lot of credit, and I'll text him later, to our commissioner for the work that he's done over the last several weeks, because he really was able to communicate to my county superintendent that for us to provide services, we have to figure out ways to do it digitally. So now we are given a directive about 2 weeks ago that services within an IEP should still be rendered digitally to students. But I have to say, I still believe that that is a divide there, because families that, you know, certain districts, I'm fortunate to have given over 500 laptops to children within my district, but that's not gonna be the case across the state. And there are gonna be a ton of families that may not have the digital access to have the ability to have a device where they can see a video of what the service and have the services provided. But then B, there's a gap in terms of a parent's ability to possibly render those services and also take care of the needs at home. Like, I'm fortunate to be able to be home and to try and to figure out through my resources and friends and so forth on how to best provide those speech services to my son. But I can't imagine a worker that still has to go to work and still has to work in a local deli or food place or whatever it may be, and then come home in the evening and then try to figure out all those things. There's gonna be a huge gap that I can see. And I believe that this is gonna be one of those areas where we're truly gonna see the opportunity gap just increase. And we're gonna have to get some resources from the federal government in terms of funding to figure out how to best serve our students after this pandemic is over. But I do want the sounding point to be that our state commissioner has done a great job in mobilizing efforts in about a 2-week period to give directives to all superintendents across the state to ensure that these services are provided, which is not the case if we go across the bridge in New York City or in Maryland or in Virginia and other places where I have friends that are educators. So I do think we're ahead of the curve, but we still gonna need some extra resources.
Dr. Evans, that's for you.
Yeah, I just wanna make a comment very quickly. You know, I think what we need to do, there's like three words that pop in my head: forgiveness, grace, and mercy. And those words come up in regards to, as parents, you're not going to be the teacher that your students had. You're just not. So don't even think that you're going to be that. Now, you're still helping support your kids, hoping again that we can get them to where they need to be by the end of the year. The reality is it will not be the same experience, and we know that. You also have to know too that there's a depression that's going on right now because people are losing family members, friends. You're dealing with spirituality. You're dealing with just the realities of all those kinds of things. And it's a depressive state. So how do you move yourself out of that as a parent if you're still having to work a full-time job, you're still having to work with your kids, there you're dealing with the social distancing, you might be in a small place where you have to live as far as exposure, all those things are happening. So that forgiveness piece, that word that I'm talking about, really is that you're gonna be stressed, there's gonna be anxiety, but how do you change that and flip that? And because your kids feel that, they sense that, they know that. And so, you know, when I hear parents talking, I hear the words about accountability and assessments and getting kids to where they need to be at the end of this year. The reality is, you know, I will tell you as a teacher, usually at the beginning of the fall anyway, we had to reteach what the kids lost during the summer and get them ready for what they needed to know for the next year. That's gonna be probably even more so now. And just accept that as a reality. Do the best that you can, but don't beat yourself up if things are not perfect, is what I really want to try to stress over and over again. You know, when we're dealing with kids with special needs, again, you know, we have Zoom, we try to work with the counselors, we try to work with those that are providing the additional services. But your kid is not going to be able to sit in front of this computer for 6 to 8 hours like they would in a classroom. I can hardly sit in front of this computer. I need to get up and move. So, you know, getting a schedule, we're talking about 2 to 3 hours a day of instruction and then taking a break and doing something else. You have to figure out what works best for your family. And I really, really want to stress that because I'm seeing so many people now that are getting burned out, that are stressed, that are going stir crazy. We're having more domestic violence that's going on. There's more physical abuse that's going on because people are just not coping with this in a way. For various reasons, whether it's, again, fear of losing their jobs, fear of just a lot of different things that are happening right now, we need to pause and breathe. You know, that grace and that mercy piece, the words I was talking about earlier, too, I just really, really want to keep that in the forefront of the minds. You know, one of my daughters is a biomedical engineer. I know I can't even do her logic questions. And I have a PhD and a couple of master's degrees, and I just couldn't help her, right? When she was dealing with that. And that wasn't even thing, you know, dealing with just basic homework. So give yourself a pass. You know, work as hard as you can. Make sure we get the resources that we need. I'm saying definitely advocate for those. But know, again, that we're just trying to get through this the best that we can. I learned a long time ago, it's not good for me to teach my kids sometimes because I'm harder on them than they should be. And they get stressed when I'm trying to teach them. So, you know, I just want to kind of just offer that as a suggestion.
Dr. Evans, while you're there, and then I want to get some feedback from Dr. Beverly Lynn. Caitlin has a comment that she made. It's a comment and a question, but I think it's important. Some students view school as an escape or therapy. And I wanted to start with you, Dr. Evans, because some of our students do that in terms of our resident students, where being home, this home and on campus is an escape. It allows them to focus, it allows them to study. And some of our students do not function well at home. And so this seems to be an educator who's saying, how do we cope with that? And as an educator, as an administrator, that you have that relationship with those kind of students, how do you keep that connection when you know it's so important and valuable?
You know, one of the things that I do, and I do something, you know, a couple times a week, I always send a video out to my students once a week, just letting them know I'm here, whether I'm talking about grief and loss. You know, we recently had one of our students that was supposed to be graduating in May. There was a nursing student, he passed away. I'm trying to make that connection with them seeing me. And of course, Terrance, some of the work that you're doing as well through virtual experiences and parties and DJs and, you know, things along those lines. I can do the Bloomfield shuffle from the video. But anyway, but, you know, letting them know that I'm here. And so the students email me and talk to me. You know, I was a counselor, and I worked with kids, again, that had special needs, and again, what's called a transitional counselor for rehabilitation services. I know how sometimes being in school and being in another environment is a safe space for those students, right? So how now, with those students having to be at home, how they navigate that, honestly, that's one that I'm a faith person. I'm just going to put that out there. That I pray again, constantly, that our students are safe. And sometimes they're not in safe environments, even in their homes. And sometimes the ones that are supposed to love them like we would hope they would love them are not loving them that way. What I try to do is help students know that there's somebody else out there for them. You know, like I said, we have 100 right now, I think 105 students or so that are on campus because they didn't have anywhere else to go. We have some of our students that are homeless. We have some of our students that are dealing with food insecurity. So we're trying to make sure that they're getting food for themselves, and students that have to take care of their siblings. I mean, there's so many different things, specifically with my students at Bloomfield College. But the main thing is touching them in some kind of way, letting them know that there's somebody else out there for them, that cares about them and that wants them to be successful. And honestly, with this pandemic, that's the best that I can do right now, is to make sure that I'm available, making sure that you're available for them, and they really believe that you care about them. And, you know, that's what I can offer.
Dr. Beverly, and then I'll turn it back over to the councilwoman to sort of take us to the next place.
Yeah, I just wanted to respond to the special needs question. Right now, the Child Care Resource and Referrals, which we are one, we actually pay for American Sign Language for all children who are in public school that require a consultant to come in and work with them. Typically, those individuals go to the school or they go to their child's home. And now, of course, everything is being done through technology. And so we know that the American Sign Language instructors are using their computers to teach kids sign language. I don't know whether that is something that could also be done with speech. I would suspect that it could be. I think it's all about finding those resources. We partner very closely with SPAN, Statewide Parent Advocacy Network, and I know they have a significant amount of resources to help parents with children with special needs or special circumstances. So I just want to throw that out there in case there may be some parents that also have some challenges in that area. The second thing I want to share is that we are a childcare resource and referral agency for Essex County. And as such, we are responsible for assisting with childcare for essential workers. And when we talk about essential workers, we typically talk about healthcare professionals, nurses and doctors. But I can tell you, if the gas station, you need gas, you need a gas station attendant, that's an essential worker. Someone working in ShopRite is an essential worker. Those individuals who are providing those services may need childcare. And if they need childcare, there is a state website, childcarenj.org/emergency, or they can call Programs for Parents in Newark, and we will make sure they get to the right location to submit their application. Childcare is absolutely free. It's an opportunity for parents to go to work, leave their children in a place where they know will be safe. So we encourage anyone that has a child, there's no income limit. Anyone, as I mentioned earlier, is eligible as long as they are an essential worker. We do require that they provide some evidence of that. It could be an employee ID card, copy of it, as long as it has their name and their title or something like that on it, and their residency. And they submit that information. It comes to Programs for Parents if they're living in Essex County. In Camden County, it would be the Camden County Office for Children. And of course, there's a CCRNR in each county. And we make sure that we help those families find childcare and somewhere for them to take their children. The other thing I wanna mention though, and Dr. Evans, spoke about this briefly, is how children and parents are feeling emotionally right now. And I know Dr. Renee is going to probably talk about this as well. So I'm going to just say that we have employees ourselves that are parents, and I saw a plethora of emotions, whether it was angry, they were anxious, they were fearful, they were confused, they were uncertain. So they're dealing with those emotions. And many times we pass those emotions and concerns and words onto our children. And so I want to encourage parents to think about that before you do it. First, turn off your TV, because we're watching too much information about coronavirus and how many people are dying. Our focus is on living, bringing our families together, keeping us as one. I had a minister say, instead of saying I'm stuck in the house, say I'm blessed in the house. Well, everybody's not going to feel blessed ordinarily because you, as Dr. Evans indicated, we're all stressed. But there are ways that we can handle it so that children and adults feel better at the end of the day. And in reality, one of the things that we tell parents is get a routine. Someone put on Facebook, I fed him waffles at 9:30. We did one activity of work and he's ready to eat lunch. Okay, well, because that's what you do after you do an activity, I guess, or because their home is a different setting. And so creating that routine so that there's something new. Yes, but there's something new they can really get into and understand if they're following that routine and that schedule. And I would suggest that you do it for young children, but do it for older children too. And I gave Altrice a little clip, and I'm not sure whether we'll be able to show it, but it talks about the anxiety that teenagers are having about this whole ordeal, about losing their social network, and those are the people who are at their schools. And in terms of their friends, about losing out on graduation and proms and all those things that we got so excited, every one of us that's on this panel got excited about going to that prom, okay? Or got excited about going to graduation. And someone is posting on Facebook, post your high school picture so we can support the kids that can't participate in their high school prom or their graduation. And I saw a remark and someone says, really? That's not making me feel any better seeing your picture from 1981. So let's think about some of the things that we're saying, some of the things we're doing. And I'm gonna come back after you guys talk a little bit more to talk about some of the other things that we're talking to parents about around adverse childhood experience.
Councilwoman, any follow-up thoughts to that? And I know that Sister Renee has an amazing title that deals with emotional state. I don't know if you wanna stay there, Councilwoman, or move on.
So I just would like to go back to Dr. Beverly really quickly on the point number two. When you talked about those essential workers in the child care centers, I know a lot of parents have concerns, even the essential workers, about the safety precautions that are taken at those centers. Do you mind kind of just walking us through a little bit of the safety protocols that are happening for those essential workers' children as they get dropped off at those child care centers, if you know what is happening?
Well, I can tell you what has been shared with the child care centers. And it's my understanding that Department of Children and Families will be doing some monitoring to make sure those things are in place. It is recommended by CDC and also now by the Department of Health that when children are dropped off, that parents not come in the center. Okay, drop them off out at the front door, sign them in at the front door, and bring the child inside. And that's to prevent parents from bringing in additional germs and whatever other kinds of things they might bring into the program. They're recommending, of course, as soon as children come in, that they wash their hands. They are recommending, if possible, that programs actually take temperatures, not oral temperatures, but a temperature using a gun. And I don't know whether all the centers actually have that equipment, because some of that equipment is very difficult to find right now. But to at least ask the parent, has the child had a fever? Or, you know, does the child have a cough? But do an initial screening of some type before the child comes into the program. And then, of course, you want children to be in small groups. So you don't want a class of 20. Perhaps it's only going to be a class of 6 or a class of 7, so that there's plenty of space for children to practice social distancing. They want to make sure that the toys are sanitized daily that they are working with, and that things are cleaned properly so that they're doing the sanitation and the disinfectant, and there are processes for that to happen. So there's a whole list of things that you can find online, because it's quite a bit. We actually work with the child care health consultants that we have here in New Jersey, and they do a 1-hour presentation. And most of the centers I know in Essex have participated in that presentation. So they know what those protocols are.
Dr. Lynn, would you be able to put those resources, any of those websites, in the chat box so that our participants and the attendees can see?
Okay, let me find them.
Okay, we appreciate it.
Thank you. So I guess this is a great time to get to Renee so that she can kind of inform us about the social emotional things that we can look out for and how to help our families.
Yeah, so just to connect to what's already been shared, you know, one of the things we're seeing a lot of emerging right now are policies in response to COVID-19. For example, pregnant women who were about to deliver, there was policies set up in some hospitals for a period of time around not being able to have a partner, a doula, or family member accompany you into delivery. So think about the degree of emotional stress that would ensue with no other plan, no iPad, telephone, or some other way in which that person could support you. We are existing in a country with a very high maternal mortality rate among Black women that appears to be related to not being heard or listened to during your healthcare seeking process. So, you know, understanding the risk to essential workers and providers that having additional people could bring, but balancing that with basic ethics and humanity, as has been discussed in this call already. So we really have to begin to engage community members in shaping the policies and decisions that are being made. So programs like Parents Engaging Parents, programs like Dr. Lynn's program, programs for parents, the coalitions that are engaging families and making sure they have a seat at the table, that infrastructure is needed to guide us through times like now when policies and decisions are being made that are not including or considering what are the real essential needs for healing right now. So given the request for physical distancing, how do we make sure we have adequate support in order to nurture and care for and keep our sanity during this period? So families have had to redefine what family is. They've had to redefine how physical distancing is going to take place in order to have the support that they need to move through this period of time. And so we could be so much more proactive about that and support that with good public health infrastructure if we were including those who will be affected in the decision making. There are policies being made about who gets access to extreme medical measures, such as ventilators, based on risk factors. Risk factors that arise from structural conditions that disproportionately affect communities of color and communities that have been marginalized and oppressed. So if structural racism contributes to you having a risk factor that lowers your likelihood of being given a life-saving service if there are limited ones to supply, have we fully considered the ethics of how we made that decision and who has been involved in shaping that decision? So this is a real opportunity for us to think about what we could do together differently moving forward to really build systems and processes that are more fair, more equitable, truly account for what is going to be needed to adjust for historical trauma, structural racism, and systemic inequities. What was raised earlier around the risk for widening gaps in educational losses that may occur during this time is also not disassociated from our structural inequities and ways in which learning differences different structures of learning have been handled for a long time. So if those don't flow into the online learning and how learning goes home, then you will see those gaps widen. And so there are major stressors for families without an adequate space to be heard. So what we can immediately change is how we are listening to, hearing from and incorporating the voices of families. That is something we can do immediately differently. We can't necessarily understand the virology of COVID-19. We can't make a vaccine appear overnight. This social distancing that is happening right now is not going to go away very quickly. The economic consequences that are going to evolve from this. It's not going to go away very quickly. And communities that have been historically disadvantaged will experience a much longer arc of this. So this is an opportunity for us to begin thinking much more long term of, in this moment, how do we build a larger platform for voice to really address the structural inequities that are the true culprits right now. It's not, COVID-19 has taken advantage of those existing inequities in a very major way. So what can we do differently? And it really begins with acknowledging that our access to healing in this time is not coming from necessarily special providers like the medical community. It's coming from neighbors. It's coming from our ability to acknowledge our shared humanity and really to invite everyone to play a leadership role in connecting and making sure no one's getting left behind or isolated in this process.
Councilwoman, question for you in regards to some of that feedback, and then I wanted to ask Sister Renee too. From a generational perspective, I'm 37. Is this not much of the same conversation that we've been having generationally, that we need to get involved? We need to have the right conversation. We have to do more. It's redundant. I wrote down some notes. I said, parents need partners, not politicians. And then a second point, our children need help, not hype. How do we motivate? How do we push folks to be a part of the power that decides where resources go? We talked about inequity and how we can't have equality without equity on yesterday, and pretty much saying that even you are echoing it today, that when it comes to how we respond to this crisis, that the Black and Brown communities are at the short end of the stick, or the resources are not getting to them the same way they may get to other areas. How do we strike a balance in that when this is affecting so many in our community?
Well, I'm happy that you asked that question, Terrance. And so I guess I would start with a little bit of my background. I used to look at politicians in a completely different light until I became one. And I actually never thought that I would sit in this seat because I didn't see myself as a politician. And I absolutely was so against politics. I'm like, I don't like it. It's dirty. It just seems nasty. And, you know, since I've been in this seat, one of the things that I realized is that we have to be at the table. We cannot go walk away from the table, and we have to learn tolerance and patience. And I think that we love to celebrate MLK Day. We love to celebrate Black history, but sometimes we forget about the history of those things and the fights that we had to be at in order to live the way that we live now, to have the freedoms that we have now. And I think that we take for granted, and we see that same impact happen in our criminal justice system because we don't like to be jurors, right? So I think that a lot of times as African-American leaders, we have the ability to be leaders and stand up within our community and be an example. But because it seems a little bit tough, we like to walk away because we get offended by things. And I think that right now, as it was just stated, we have to find those leadership opportunities. And I think that because of this crisis, we're going to see more people stepping up. And I have been even in Camden talking to a lot of local leaders about, you know, reviving our young Dems, right, and getting more brown people involved in politics and trying to figure out what they are expecting from government and having them understand that we need them at the table, even if it's social discourse, because I think sometimes social discourse is necessary to move the needle forward within our communities. And it's not an easy thing because, again, in politics, I think that we've offended so many and we haven't always made it easy or cleared the path for young people to feel comfortable within the space. And so I think that we just have to bridge the gap by trying. And I don't think that we do anything without trying. So in Camden, a few things that we are looking forward to doing is really having the conversation. And I'm supposed to have the conversation early next week. And you know, just kind of thinking about how we connect. So I'm going to be launching within the next week a platform in partnership with, you know, Dr. Atunde. They run a Cisco network and they have the Camden Dream Center. But we know that in our communities, as I'm talking to young people, we keep assuming that our seniors can't access the internet and they're doing better than people my age, because the people my age are accessing the computer and internet through their social platforms, but they don't know how to do the skill-based things. And so we are actually launching a program that will help them and help everybody, no matter where you are and your technological skill. Because like I said, I think that there's a lot of assumption made about young people and what they know and how to do on the computer and what their skill sets are. So right now, and again, I think that there are so many opportunities for connections. I mean, we just want to make sure that we level the playing field so that for anybody who is not on right now, we want to make sure that they're not left out because they're not missing information because they don't have the platform to get this information, right, to participate in the online learning environment when it is available. But again, as a new leader and as a young leader, I think the thing that I'm learning about politics is to listen and then jump into action. Because I, you know, sometimes one of my mentors said to me about our people is like, they can't afford to wait. So they told me, you know, as you're trying to build this stuff, it was like, Shaneka, stop making people wait. Our people have been waiting long enough. So every day that I wake up, I keep that in mind. But like I said, what we have to do is really sit down again with the younger folk. And that includes me and people who are younger than me. And just again, start teaching again and tell them why we need them at the table. And I know that they've already been turned off, but we have to get them back to the table so that we can continue to educate. And that is another reason why I really love PEP, because I feel like Altarese was so audacious in his attempt to go across the state and connect leaders. And that wasn't happening. And now just to think about tonight where like I'm sitting home in Camden, but I'm talking to people all over New Jersey who has the same mind as me. And I would have never been able to meet you guys if PEP didn't exist. And so again, I'm just excited to be here tonight and to have these conversations, but I'm happy that they're gonna be ongoing. And then Terrance, the work that you're doing, you know, we have to tap into that and talk about, you know, when you're at a college, what I see from a lot of in here is like people can't see themselves, right? So to have you represent the college and be able to reach out weekly and even DJ, right? Because sometimes I feel like at universities, it's so kind of like uptight that we need that within our communities because we connect through art. And I think that that's another thing that we have really been learning is that people have dismissed art and act like it was just a or other. And we're seeing that right now, and it is bringing so much joy, and it is helping us with those mental health. Like everybody that I know, we need their mental health is that we're using television, right? We're using art. Everybody's on Netflix. Everybody's on Hulu. You know, everybody's listening to music, the DJ. So I think that those are the things that we can kind of do in the short term. But in the long term, when you talk about policy making, like I said, that is not lost on me. Every single day we are thinking about if this happens again, how can we prepare today to make sure that if this goes forward or continues again, another pandemic comes, that we're more ready. But I think that this really taught us that even with the technology that we had, we weren't at the top of it. We were probably someplace in the middle. But I still say that in New Jersey, we have put our stuff together and really been moving forward. And I'm very proud of the work that the Education Commissioner has done, because I'm seeing it firsthand, like I said, at our schools. And then Curtis, because I want to get back to you, but I saw a question that I think that you could potentially help. I want to make sure we don't forget anybody, but they were asking, how do parents figure out how to address the different learning styles during this time? How do they jump into that? If you have a kid who may be a visual learner, or like me, I learn by listening. So how do we help those students with the different learning styles at this time? If you can give us a few suggestions.
Yeah, if you don't mind, there was a question that was prior to that I think is helpful as well. I'll do that first, if that's okay, Terrance or Shaneka. But the question was regarding school being a safe haven. I'm trying to find it. And how do we still keep our kids connected with other students? And I, you know, part of my message that I do with my leadership team every day is that the academic and social emotional needs are even keeled to me. And we have to make sure that we're providing both services to our children. But I do think a service that families can do is that using the technology that we currently have, we have to explore ways to still keep our kids connected with their own friends. And one of the things that, you know, I recently did for my daughter, I don't know if you can see this little picture here, but it's a picture of her yesterday having a little Zoom call with her friends. Now, obviously I had to email the kid's teacher to get email addresses, and then we had to coordinate. It took some time, to be honest, but you know, the melancholy face that she used to have was totally different because her friends, she was able to connect with her friends and talk with her friends. And coupled with that, another idea that I got from another parent is to do drive throughout the day, call up a couple of friends and say, hey, we're going to be driving by. We're just going to wave, and we're not getting out the car, but we're just going to wave and just say hello. But we're going to have a little connection. We're going to have some smiles, and, you know, we'll have some good music, as you said, in the car as we're driving and we're going around. And it gives us an opportunity for my kids to connect with their peers in a way that's authentic, that's real, where they can see each other. And it somewhat mimics the experiences that they've had when they're in school. Now, I don't think there's no way that I can replicate, you know, the lunchtime chats that they would have, or the playground chats that they would have, or the walk into school and back. Like, we're not gonna be able to replicate that. But if I can give them an ounce of what that experience has, you know, I think it's gonna help them in the long run. So that's the first response around that. And I would encourage parents, if you have the resources, to do the same. I think, you know, what I would do is, most school districts are giving, in terms of the question about how do you support the learning needs, I agree 100% with, I think it was Dr. Evans who said it earlier, that we can't replicate what our child's teachers are doing. You know, it's impossible. And even though I'm an educator for a long time, I can't do it. And what I have done though, is that I stay in contact with my children's teachers, and I ask really good questions. Like, my son is struggling with blank. What do I do? And 9 times out of 10, I found that, because I think New Jersey, you know, has some of the best educators across the state, that child teacher will probably get on the phone, will probably get on a video call, and like take, and if they don't, I would encourage parents to ask if they can do that so that they can help to explain some of these concepts. Because part of the role of teaching is not just that, you know, we're teaching content and conveying content from one person to another. It's also that relationship piece. And while I have a great relationship with my children, the relationship that my child's children's teachers have made with them helps in that transmission of information. So like my child's daughter, my son's teacher getting on a Zoom call and saying, hey TJ, wow, it's good to see your smile. Let me tell you a little bit about this concept. And like, that's helping him to like delve into a concept in a way that, you know, us as parents probably can't do. So I would encourage that. And I also think that, you know, the question about recommending diagnostic tests and holding a child back or something, I would just really stay away from the idea of holding a child back right now. The commissioner, and I think he mentioned this, about the leniency that they're having right now with regard to retention across the state, and they're encouraging schools to be lenient about that. I'm hopeful that we will see in the coming weeks and months some kind of statewide initiative that will be structured around supporting some of the academic gaps that we're going to see with our children. I know my district is working on a plan to support some of that, which will include potentially a longer school day and remediation services in a structured kind of way. And I hope that we're going to see some of that. So I wouldn't worry too much at this point about trying to like diagnose the problem of any academic gaps. I hope that answers some of the questions that I see in the chat box.
Principal Curtis, question, in terms of once we, important, I guess it's important in our community, or it is important in our community, we need to feel good about things, right? And people don't forget how you treat them. But once we get past that point where we've done our best to offer that encouragement, how do we meet parents where they are? How do we meet students where they are? We come from a community where we, and most people are like that, we only do what we know. So we're in a position where we can't call great grandma or grandma and say, have you been here before? This is something that everybody is dealing with new. What tips or what matter of fact advice for the parent who doesn't go to the school board meeting, for the parent that hasn't been engaged, for the parent that doesn't understand, that's turned off by politics, Councilwoman, or for the parent who doesn't know that you speak to the board about this issue versus the council about this issue? How can we, or what should we say? What can we say? What can we offer to parents and community leaders that really are kind of just chasing a tail. They're not really stepping in the right direction to best address these type of issues that have come up this evening.
Well, I think that first we gotta put a feather in the hat. They have to realize that they gotta put a feather, most parents could put a feather in their hat for the advocacy work that they are doing. And even though it might not be attending a PTA meeting or a PEP meeting or being involved in things like this, they're doing the vital, most parents across the state that I found in my work are doing vital things to make sure that their children are being successful. And that's putting food on the table, putting clothes on their back, giving them a sound place. And parents, most of our parents are, come from Spanish speaking homes and don't even speak the language, but are doing, creating the right conditions, don't even speak English, excuse me, but creating the right conditions for their child to be successful. Mm-hmm. And I can say that from my own parents who had very similar struggles, that's what's needed from a baseline. And we have to acknowledge that that is foundational and extremely important. Now, I think I would just suggest, my advice would be to start small and really think about, you know, maybe it, because that parent has to work. It might be an older sister. It might be a cousin. It might be an aunt. It might be a neighbor inside the building that could possibly be an advocate to help kind of make some of these connections with some of the gaps that we're talking about this evening. So that's my advice. I'm definitely sure that other folks on the panel could give some guidance on this as well.
I would love to speak on that, because I think that one of the things that's so vital right now as far as getting parents involved is that they do have an understanding that their voice, it does matter. Mm-hmm. And by seeing change really come, that's one of the things that will make people more inclined to engage in in civil engagement. Even I think a lot of times parents don't know where to go or who to turn to when it comes to getting involved, and not so much politically, but just at least being an advocate for their children and even for themselves in this world. So I think that having that education, like, I don't know that, you know, civil education has even really been a part of our curriculum. I think it's more surface. It's not really, you know, so in depth that parents feel comfortable to, you know, engage with their schools in a certain way. A lot of times too, that there's like a cultural differences, and in those cultural differences, they feel like the school is the authority. And so they feel like they don't want to challenge that. I see that with a lot of the community that I work with, that they're almost scared to, you know, approach their teachers or, you know, question any of the policies that are in place. I have an open dialogue with my parents. I call them daily, or my assistant calls them. I talk to them first, and then I ask to talk to their child. That's one of the ways that I engage with my children while, you know, going through this pandemic. And just through Zooms, through just phone calls, and just telling your children and your students that, you know, I wish I could hug you and wipe your tears. That's the things that they need to hear. And, you know, just to hear them laugh is enough for me right now. But we just, you know, need to continue to make sure that they're okay and their parents are okay.
And just to follow up on that, again, from a political side, is, you know, when I'm in the community, you know, there is no councilwoman, right? Like, and I don't go out as a councilwoman, and a lot of times I'm dressed down, so people probably can't even recognize me, but it's the human decency that I see. And I see a lot of people willing to volunteer, and I see people stepping up, and I see people who were beefing before who are willing to help each other in every single way. And I think that that human kindness, like Erica said, just the small things are adding up right now to amount to a whole lot in our communities. You know, people are doing so much to help each other. I think people are overextending themselves. I think almost all of us, right, we're finding creative ways to connect. And even for me personally, like, I've spoken to family more now than I have in the last few years, you know, just because of this pandemic. And I think that there are a lot of things that come out of it that make us anxious, but there are also a lot of good things that happen during this time that reconnect us to, you know, why we do a lot of the things that we do. And not forgetting, you know, the most important people are families. But again, with the hat that I wear, I'm also very aware of, like we talked about a little bit earlier, of the people who definitely are home and their home life, you know, is not a place that they want to be. And I'm so happy earlier that the commissioner talked about the resources that are available. So if we didn't log that in, we probably should, on their website, to talk about wellness and there being an opportunity for people to log into that. And in the city of Camden, we have a similar thing where our Department of Human Services is supplying activities and yoga for seniors and phone calls to therapists. And those are some of the things that we can do. In our healthcare community, they're putting up different links and resources that they have. And so right now I just see people stretching themselves and being extremely nimble and being extremely willing to lend whatever they can, you know, to the community as a whole. But like I said, I see unlikely people being willing to work together. And that tells me that everything that we're doing now, regardless of whether political, from a political angle, from whatever seat that we sit in as an executive angle, I think that people are just willing to do so much more right now because of what everybody's going through. And what I tell parents, kind of similar to what you all said, Curtis, was it's just one day at a time. You know, when I have people call me, I've had parents call me and they're breaking down and they're like, I don't know if I can do it anymore. I say, maybe you feel like that now, but tomorrow is a completely different day. And we're going to take this thing one day at a time all together, because that's all we all have, is just one day at a time. And it will be okay. And we will all get through this together. And so I think that people's faith at times like this get tested. But I think that our community has endured so much and that we have the strength and integrity to continue to move forward. And again, I'm so happy that we're all doing it together. Dr. Evans, I saw a little earlier that you had raised your hand and you've been so quiet and good. So I wasn't sure if you wanted to add anything to the conversation or, you know, what we've been discussing for the last few minutes.
Yeah, no, just, you know, just listening to everyone and the sage advice everybody's given. You know, I look at our kids, and like I said, I've taught from the cradle to the grave pretty much. The resiliency that I see from our students, you know, and how they rebound, the resiliency of our culture, Black and brown and just people, period. It is phenomenal to see I guess, from out of all of this craziness, it has caused us to pause and to really realize that tomorrow's not promised to any of us. And so when I really do think about our students and, you know, us getting through this time, and I'm coming from a state where, you know, Texas was the big accountability, testing, you know, test you to death. Teachers were teaching to the test, those kinds of things. Right now we're really looking at how we actually learn and what's really important. And maybe it may, again, have us to really look at the traditional way we've been teaching, and maybe we need to teach differently. And so I really don't think it's going to return to exactly the way that it was. It's just not. You know, at Bloomfield College, we're looking at, you know, whether we already made a decision to go online for the summer. If we come back in the fall, our classes may not be, because of social distancing, the same way that they were and how we were setting that up. We are getting some faculty before, I guess it was like March 16th, right before break, they didn't even look at their emails, and now they're having to teach online. So, I mean, it's been a total transition for so many people to get them up to speed, and this is really not great online education. So I want the faculty and other students to realize that this is not a good example of it. It's just not. And so we're trying to do professional development, because honestly, I think we're gonna see something shift in education. and we're going to have to be ready for it. We can't just be reactive. We have to be proactive. We have to be developmental in looking at how education happens in and of itself and in what environment. And that's what I'm trying to get Bloomfield College ready for, and faculty and staff, and our students. Because we know that students that are in Black and brown communities or low SES, they're the ones that actually struggle more because of the lack of resources in some cases. But also, flip that from a negative to a positive, they're so resilient and they want to learn and they're so appreciative. You know, I think the somebody mentioned, maybe it was Mr. Curtis, when he mentioned earlier about getting 500 computers to his students. We had to get computers to our students as well because some of them just didn't have that resource. So, you know, again, my background is counseling. I try to be realistically optimistic that we're going to get through this. And I hear from our students all the time how appreciative they are. People just have to know that you care and that you're in it together, and we're going to figure it out together. And that's what I'm hearing everybody say. You know, we have to fight, we have to advocate, all those kinds of things. But we also have to work together, even when we weren't working together before. So.
There's some commentary about keeping home safe and how important that is. And for, we talked a lot about essential workers. There is some concern around agencies or workplaces that are maybe not doing all that they should to protect their employees that are essential. And then those essential employees are going home to employees who are allowed to work from home. And so there's some commentary in there and advice from environmentalist Kim Gaddy about things that we should be doing in our homes, because even going to the supermarket and coming back, you could bring this. But I wanted to not just touch on that, I wanted to ask some of the educational leaders, definitely Dr. Evans, how are universities, colleges being impacted by this? What are the financial implications of next year? And will that lead to the cutting of services to students at many colleges, not specifically Bloomfield, but what are you hearing from your colleagues?
Oh yeah, well, again, you know, it's millions and millions of dollars, depending on how large your institution is. Yes, we got some funding from the CARES Act that's coming in. Bloomfield got 2.8 million, but 1.4 million of that goes directly to the students. We're just a pass-through. We're trying to make sure, again, that they have the emergency funding and stimulus funding that they can take back home, and from childcare to food to whatever it is that they may need. That's what that 1.4 is. Another 1.4 we're going to have institutionally, but we've got a refund. We're not using the word refund, adjust, that we had to send students home. And so the housing and the dining that they paid for, we've got to give them that money back. You know, we can't morally, ethically hold on to that. As an institution. So, you know, we start looking at, again, what's going to happen in the fall, what's happening with the summer. A lot of people are not registering for classes right now. A lot of students still have unpaid balances that they haven't paid because, again, they thought they were going to have work study and a lot of things that are happening, and they don't know what the future holds. So, you know, all across the nation and even internationally, you know, a lot of universities and colleges had huge international populations. People are not allowed to travel anymore. Our housing and dining, we have over 600 bed capacity on campus. We don't know if we can have them. And if we do have them on campus, then are we gonna have to put one or two people in a room? Don't know. So there's just a lot of unanswered questions right now that we're trying to plan, looking at three different types of scenarios, worst case scenario to best case scenario to, you know, maybe we have a happy medium. But it encompasses everything, the technology, the competency of the faculty as far as teaching and using technology. Dealing with you, Terrance, you know, on campus, how do we have this whole virtual piece? Our graduation was supposed to be on May 21st. And, you know, this is a big deal for students when 75% of our students are first generation. It's not just the student, it's the family. You know, we're looking at still doing something on the 21st, but we're still gonna have a big graduation and a big party. At Bloomfield, they used to have bagpipes for graduation. I'm like, what? Oh no, we had two marching bands set up. We had a whole lot of different things culturally that I wanted to do for graduation. And we have some dates set up for August tentatively, but it may be in the fall, we don't know. But we still wanna make sure that we recognize this accomplishment in a formal way of our students. So I can go on and on and on. There's just so many different things that we have to pay attention to now in a different way. And so just getting the faculty ready. You know, I'm having faculty, my chemistry faculty, one of them sent me an email last night or copied me on an email about what she couldn't do. I can't teach chemistry online. I can't do this and that or whatever. I'm like, let's just pause for a second. Talk to your other colleagues. Get on a listserv. Chemistry can be taught online. People are doing it, right? But it's shifting that mindset. We've been doing things for so many years in one way, and now we've got to think about things differently.
Thinking about things differently, Councilwoman, do you think that we should, it's a good time to transition to Dr. Beverly's video?
Yes, absolutely.
Governor Frazier, are you ready to transition to the video? Because I think that, again, some of the last comments was about how do we stay safe in the interim while we figure out what our next steps are, while some of us are stepping up, going to work. We still have to protect ourselves. So I think that's important. Dr. Beverly, tell us a little bit about this video and why is it important to this overall conversation?
So it's a group of teens that are talking about why it's difficult being sheltered in place and losing out on so many of the experiences that they've looked forward to in the last 4 years. And I thought it was significant, especially given a lot of our teens don't talk to their parents. We know that some of them may be suffering from depression and other kinds of other challenges. And it just spoke to me. And so I hope that the parents will look at this and think about what can I do to support my own teen at home.
Lost her job. My dad might get laid off. I don't know what's going to happen with him. So if we can't afford to pay the bills, then I might have to go to community college or something like that. I've kind of come to terms with it, but it's also depressing to think about because, you know, it shouldn't have been this way.
I'm practicing, but not with my team. I go to the park by myself with my dad and my brothers. I do a little workout with like cone drills, ladder. I just miss being with like my teammate, bonding with them.
It's me doing my chemistry homework from my bed, where I've been doing everything else as well recently.
I never really considered like being able to go to school every day and like being able to go to the store when I needed to without like being worried.
You know, it's every kid's dream to like be able to have like that prom. Like the perfect prom and the to be able to walk at graduation with all his tassels, it sucks.
I missed out a lot of what I think like the dream high school experience was, but I don't think that was robbing me of my high school experience. Like I think that was my high school experience and I think that's what I was supposed to experience.
I feel like I'll cherish like more moments like with friends, family, definitely like change. Like what I think about life and how I think.
I'm trying to stay on the positive side. As much as it sucks in here and now, this is only a fraction of my life. You know, I'm going to be going so far and beyond into the stuff that I'm going to do in my life.
I think it's just important that we acknowledge how disappointing this is because it's a loss to everybody for different reasons. And while it's disappointing, we also have to use it as something to help us move forward.
Dr. Lynn? Yeah, I don't think there's much to be said. It's pretty self-explanatory. I just want to share it because we have parents who have teens and they're thinking this. Some of them are communicating it and some of them are not. And I think we need to be very conscious of their emotional situation right now.
Yes, absolutely. That was a great video and thank you for sharing that. Especially for me, I'm a parent of a teen and my daughter is in high school and this is her very first year. And although most of the time she's like, everything is good, sometimes I do worry about, you know, her inability to kind of get out and hang out with her friends. Even just enjoy your first year of high school. But you know, this is a new normal that we are all trying to adjust to and looking forward to learning from. So I don't really see a lot of questions. I think that we kind of answered all the questions. Terrence, do you see any questions that we might've missed? And so I think that we captured all the parents. Altarice or Erica, did you guys want to have anything else to add tonight? Do you guys have anything else to add?
Dr. Evans, I know you have to step out. Is this something in terms of closing remarks on your behalf, on behalf of the college? And again, just thank you for being the trailblazing leader you are and allowing Bloomfield to really step up and step out, not just during this time, but period. We know that we're very important to New Jersey. And so we definitely want to ensure that we are always putting our community and our students, not just first, but at the table.
Let everybody close out.
Yeah, most definitely. And I'll close only because I've been sitting here for 2 hours and I've been drinking a whole lot of water and tea. I need to go. I'm like, I'm going to come home. I need to make a dash. Anyway, sorry. You know, I just want to say thank you for allowing me to be a part of the conversation. You know, one of the things as a new president here at Bloomfield, it's all about community service and giving back. You know, a lot of times colleges and universities will have this ivory tower expecting people to come to them. Yes, I do want you to come to campus. Yes, I mean, hopefully all of the panelists have been on campus. If you haven't, shame on you. We need you, just like, again, we want to be of service to you as well. We're very, very important. There are no HBCUs in the state of New Jersey. We are that PBI and HSI. We have a special mission and purpose, and that really, again, is making sure that our students are successful. When our students come to us and they're in that fifth quintile when they graduate, national studies, we are nationally ranked in regards to our students moving as far as economic mobility, we change lives. But we do that because of, again, all the engagement, the connection, and so we want to be that platform. When this craziness ends, we will invite you all to campus so we can have a face-to-face and to continue the conversation. That's what I'm here for. I'm going to be that tool for our students to be able to see that if she came from where she came from and she's now president of a college, they can too. What you see is what you get. I try to be as real as I can. You know, I know how to be as formal as I can be when I need to be as well. But I am that president. I'm your president. So let me know how I can help. Like I said, I've been in this for decades now, from teaching to counseling to doing whatever, and I love my job. So thank you for allowing me to be a part of the conversation, and I'm gonna tap out.
Thank you. Thank you for your service too.
I just want to make one closing remark that I think this is an opportunity. You know, there's a silver lining in everything. The opportunity that I see is to engage more parents. Parents now have a taste for what academic life is like. They understand what their abilities are, good, bad, or indifferent. But I think depending on the messages that we share with them, we can get more parents involved. So, thank you again for having me. I look forward to meeting you all in person at some point.
Thank you.
Thank you, definitely, Dr. Lynn.
Curtis, would you like to have some closing remarks?
Yeah, thank you. So I also want to thank just everyone from PEP, but all of the parents that take time out this evening to participate in this event and others as well. I think that this is, you know, I'm also person of faith as well, and I believe there's a reason why we're here. And we may not even figure that out in our lifetime. You know, my personal belief is that when I get to heaven, all of this may be unpacked to me. But I do, you know, the one question that lingers in my head is around that that parent that may not be as savvy as like the folks on this panel, or may not have that expertise, and that still may be on this call right now and still wondering, all right, what am I gonna do on Monday when I gotta support my child? Or what am I gonna do over the weekend with finding out some resource? And I you know, there's it's kind of serendipitous because I wish that this person was leading our country, but Obama used to have a phrase, and I'm not gonna quote it correctly, but it was something like, if you're walking down the right path, just keep doing it. Eventually you're gonna make progress. And that you know, he never said that you needed to be an expert. He never said that you needed to, you know, bring, you know, X, Y, and Z to the table. But the quote says, just keep doing it. And I just want to encourage families, parents especially, that are on this call, keep doing what you're doing. Eventually we're gonna see progress, and stay engaged. And you know, I'm one of probably dozens of hundreds of district leaders that want to partner with you. So I'm looking forward to the 900 plus families in my district to continue partnering with you, some of you on the call today. And I encourage all the other school leaders to continue that. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very encouraging. Renee, would you like to give us some closing remarks?
I just want to express gratitude. It's inspiring that folks are, it's Friday night, and a large number of parents has stayed on this call. And I think, just to echo the comments of other panelists, we need your wisdom. Your wisdom, your ideas, your creativity is what is going to bring us through this period collectively. So, don't let the master narrative that's going around diminish your light and what you have to offer to your children, your families, and your community.
Erica, do you have anything that you want to add as a closing remark?
Sure, thank you. Councilwoman Boucher, I just wanted to say thank you to everybody that continues to support Parents Engaging Parents. And by coming together and banding together with all of your wisdom and your knowledge that you were able to share with our community of parents. And this is what we want to continue to do. We want to continue to share the love, to connect with each other. There should be no barriers. If you're a doctor, if you're not a doctor, if you're essential worker, if you're not an essential worker, this is what we need. We need this right here. And with Parents Engaging Parents, this is what we're aiming to do. We're aiming to give everybody the tools and the connections and the guidance and the resources to be able to continue and navigate not only through this crisis, but you know, continuously, because being a parent is a continuous job. It's a continuous fight. It's a continuous battle. But at the same time, we can be victorious, you know, by just continuing to band together. So thank you, and continue to join us.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that invite. I'll say a few closing remarks before I turn it over to my gracious, wonderful co-host here. But what I want to say is that tonight there were a lot of things that I did take away and that I learned. And I learned that, hey, I do have to check in more with my teenage daughter and make sure that she's well and okay. And that I, you know, Curtis gave me a few things that I could do with her to make sure that she is tuning in and still in contact with her friends and her network. I also learned about the essential services that are available via childcare networks for the community that I could potentially help my community tap into a little bit more. You know, we definitely discussed all the mental health opportunities that are available. We talked a lot about the one day at a time And taking it slow, and we don't have to be experts to do something. And I think that that's going to be one of my key takeaways, is because I think a lot of times when we don't know things, we think that we have to know it all. And just tonight, I was extremely encouraged by the strength of the group that was here. And I feel like I have so many more resources that I can reach up to the side to, and just so happy to know that we have so many great partners throughout the state that I'm looking forward to reaching out to, because just the information that you shared with me tonight makes me feel more encouraged to continue the work that I need to do. And I'm ready, you know, to continue to serve the community. And I feel strengthened by the work that we're doing with parents, engaging parents, and I'm looking forward to even bringing more parents to the table now. So thank you, Altarice, for the hard work that you guys are doing, and Erica at PEP. And again, I just want to make sure that tonight that everybody stays encouraged, that we will get through this pandemic stronger on the other side, more informed and ready if this ever happens again. So I'm going to turn it over to Terrance. Is he still there? Or did we lose him?
Oh, I just want to thank everybody tonight who came through from the Department of Education, our leader, Commissioner Dr. Repollet, and all you leaders. You know, at the end of the day, as I continue to engage the people, I ask them to understand that as long as we organize our people and organize our resources, we'll have the power to put on an engagement to tell hundreds and thousands of people what we can do and how we can stand together. And that's all the intent was. And I'm just overwhelmingly thankful for the expertise and the love that came to this table. We share in a vital village and a network, and as this county council, we talk about gifts. And Dr. Lynn, I'm gonna end with this story, because it's just a testament of your leadership and your ability to be trustful. And when you see leadership, and we did an urban book fair, and Dr. Lynn said, "You're gonna do it. Well, how are you gonna get the people there?" And I said, "Dr. Lynn, I'm just gonna ask them." And 50 people, maybe 60 people came. We had 7 different authors, all were Black and Brown authors. Over like 2 different mascot authors, and the energy was that Dr. Lynn didn't pull the plug because I didn't have a big name individual, a big name keynote speaker. You know, I didn't go the traditional route. I went just one by one asking parents and continuing to meet parents, but I knew at the end of the day I didn't do it because I wanted to. I did it because the parents asked me. They said, "We wanted Black and Brown, we wanted our image to see, and where are those people?" And I just found 10 authors who did that and came together. So at the end of the day today, I just found 12, 15 leaders who was willing to come together to talk to New Jersey and share the information about education, but also about love and gift, because Parents Engage at Parents is just a beloved community of leaders and champions. And I just thank you for giving me the opportunity to stand tall on your shoulders and be an example of ordinary people becoming extraordinary in the work. So thank you guys, and I wish you the best. I'm gonna turn it over to Terrance as we go into the next session, the third session. It's been a long night. So anybody that wanna stay and party, we got DJ Ran on the turntable. So I'm gonna turn it over to Terrance. Dr. Lynn, do you wanna say anything before Terrance get on that? Okay, I know Dr. Lynn, I'm ready to go. So I already know.
What about Sister Renee? No closing words?
Nah, they good, man. I traveled the country with them two ladies.
When Sister Renee talked, that make me feel calm all alone. I need to call her for some counseling sessions. We appreciate you so much. You know, Dean Mitchell, who's the vice president here at Bloomfield College, she said, "How do you reinstall that it truly takes a village to raise a child in today's society to save a child?" And one of the closing points I'll make before we turn it over to DJ Brand is that someone needs to begin to research, at least from a generational perspective, my generational perspective, what happens when the village is sick. We continue to hear that we hear that old anecdote that we need, it takes a village to raise a child, but no one has researched what do we do when the village is sick. And so we have a lot of work to do, which was the sentiment today, and to whom much is given, much more is deserved. And I was in great company tonight because I know that everybody here not just spoke about a spiritual connection, but you obviously have it, because the word says, "Be ye a doer."
And everybody here is a doer. And so it is an honor and a pleasure as a young man from Newark, New Jersey, just trying to be successful and not trying to be a role model, but just doing my best to live my purpose. I am grateful to be in your presence. Thank you, Governor, as I call him. Real leadership takes actions where others hesitate. And today, sir, you took the action that was necessary. So I appreciate you. And with no further ado, we are going to turn it over to DJ Rand, who's in the building. And then we got DJ Reed, who's also an educator in the city of Newark. You see how we make that connection? We don't just make music. We make, we make it make sense too. And so we got DJ Rand representing WBL as a legendary dope DJ. And then we also have, again, DJ Reed coming in the second hour. Take it away, Ryan. Let's go.
Thank you all again.
Yes. Bloomfield County DJ Rand up in the building. Welcome to the official after party, y'all. Let me just get it warmed up. Set the tone for my man DJ Reed. So for all my ladies up in the spot.
Thank you.